pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Well, most of you know I am not Dina Sullivan. Dina was called away on a family emergency, so I am chairing the meeting tonight. Is there anyone in the audience who would like to address the school committee on an issue that's not on tonight's agenda? No? Okay, thank you very much. The consent agenda, is there any item that anyone on the committee would like to have removed from the consent agenda for further discussion? Seeing none, could we have a motion to approve the consent agenda as presented?
So moved.
Any discussion? All those in favor? Unanimous, thank you. Next, we are to receive and note the minutes of the Pine Grove Building School Building Subcommittee meeting held on September 15th, 2016.
That's actually part of the consent agenda.
That is actually part of the consent agenda. A little rusty in the last few months. Okay. Next, we have the student representatives report. Student representatives, are there three of you here? Four?
Actually, I can introduce them.
Okay.
So just to introduce the process, in the past, there has been a single student representative. It was chosen by the building principal. Reviewing the statute, it's actually an election through the student council. And so the student council members have an active member who is voted and has a seat at the table. Hopefully, if they want to stay the whole meeting and be an active part, non-voting member of the committee. In the real world, you probably all have a big pile of things at home that they need to get done. So we're not going to frown upon the fact if they need to leave. But so there are actually four representatives here tonight, and one who is still stuck on the practice field. But we have with us Brenda Pham. We have Hope Leonard. Brenda and Hope will actually, if you want to come up here, they're actually going to be giving the report tonight. But we also have Eloise Hurton and Jessica Fadrani. And Erin Savage is, again, stuck out on the practice field, but she is also another rep who you will see rotating through. So I will turn the floor over to you, ladies.
Hi, I'm Hope Leonard. And we would just like to report on what's been going on at the high school. Last Friday, I bet many of you were there. We had our opening game on the new stadium. The game may not have gone as well as we had hoped, but the actual stadium in general was an amazing unveiling. So we first wanted to thank everyone for their support, if you were someone that supported in the stadium, because it was so amazing to be able to stand there and see how great it was, and it went really well.
Hello, I'm Brenda Pham. So for the first Tuesday of October, we had a college fair, and for every Tuesday of the week, eight different colleges would come. But the problem, it's been going fine right now. It's running smooth. Students are enjoying looking at the college they would like to potentially enroll to. But the problem that the students, some students have, is their teachers not allowing them to go. But for this time, it's the only time for them to go check their college because they don't have time out of their schedule to take a tour. So that's been a problem for the past 3 weeks.
On a lighter note, we have the French exchange students are here with us right now. They are having a blast. They don't need to go to the college fair, but they just recently went on a field trip to Boston, and a lot of teachers joined in on that. So that's something that's been going really well and that we hope to continue throughout the following years.
So back to a negative point.
We didn't do this on purpose.
So for the vending machines, it's been disabled for students, so we aren't able to get snacks for a third period or the beginning of the school time. So that's a problem for us because at the CAF, they don't sell snacks like they said they will in the morning. They only sell breakfast. And also for students who can't get to have the CAF for third period before third period starts, So they don't have a snack for third period. So they're practically not, they're not starving, but they're hungry. And they can't focus most of the time.
Okay, lastly, we'd just like to touch on an issue that has come up recently, and it was resolved, but it was resolved as a smaller issue and not as an issue as a whole. So there are certain classes that don't necessarily offer a separate class for honors or CP. In this instance, there was one particular class that the teacher had informed the students before we, as we picked courses last year, that if you took the class, it was technically a CP class, but as the year went on, you could choose to take it for honors credit, which may not seem like a big difference in how the class was run, but for a lot of us graduating and as you get up, the honors and CP makes a difference when you're calculating your GPA. So this past few weeks, this wasn't working out. There was problems with communication between guidance and teachers on how teachers were held to the information that they provided before the year began. So as the year went on, the teachers, or one teacher in particular, decided that it wasn't the best option to switch to honors and it would be more than she would have wanted to handle. But the students were not okay with that, and they all grouped together to protest, and they ended up being successful in creating honors credit for their class. But it's becoming more of an issue where students are being told that they can get this honors credit for their classes and then not actually being able to get it, or having to fight tooth and nail to get what they were originally told about. So we just wanted to address that issue because it is likely to come up again. Thank you. That's everything.
Questions?
So Brenda, I have a question for you about these kids that are missing the snacks. Would you agree that if the school day was started an hour later at the high school, that problem would be alleviated?
I think
they would be able to have their continental breakfast.
Well, some kids are able to go to breakfast in the morning, but as the day goes on, we get exhausted from all the work that we're given. And so to keep us focused and energized, we have snack time, which is third period in the middle of the day. So we're able to rejuvenate that energy to focus more.
Maureen?
I just want to, do we know why the vending machine was disabled?
It's been said that it takes away from the school fund.
The school what?
So originally the vending machines were, well, they still are over there in the side of the library. As you can see, they're turned off right now. Originally the profits from the vending machine went directly to the library, but this was taking away from the funds that the cafeteria was receiving from breakfast and supposedly snacks throughout the day, which wasn't really actually happening. So the head of the library, Ms. Davis, had offered to move the vending machines to the cafeteria so that the cafeteria could get the profits. But now it's turning more towards a health issue or what the cafeteria can and cannot serve to students throughout the day. So that seems to be the issue. I hope that answered your question.
Yeah, just to confirm, so this goes back to the wellness policy and the requirements that what we are allowed to sell as a school is very prescriptive in what we are allowed to sell. I mean, we had the discussion about chocolate milk and energy drinks and all the things that we no longer allowed to sell from the school itself. So that's the major contributing factor in this ongoing discussion.
So is the vending machine going to be removed, or is it going to sit there with all those snacks in it and the kids can't get at it? It just seems a little
cruel. It's still a work in progress about what we're able to do.
Okay.
and still be in compliance. Yeah.
I didn't have a question necessary, but I wanted to commend both you, Brenda, and you, Hope, for bringing these things to our attention, and also for demonstrating the kind of activism that is certainly alive and well here at Triton, especially coming in and talking about students who are frustrated because they can't get their honors. That's quite impressive. Keep it up. Make sure that you're getting your honors when it's something that's due to you, you know, and thank you for bringing that to our attention.
My just one comment would be it's good to have it brought to our attention, but it's not our, it's really not our area. So I would ask if you have gone to your building principal about this.
Well, I don't think neither of us specifically have gone, but guidance has been taking steps towards communicating better with the teachers that have particularly been involved in this type of class environment. So, and you don't take the class, do you? Neither of us are taking it this year, but this was a problem that a lot of our peers and classmates were involved in. So there are steps being taken, but not necessarily by us directly, but guidance is trying, but it's kind of one of those things where we're hoping that before we leave as seniors, we can see some change that's not just going to be put off continuously until it becomes a bigger problem.
All right, thank you.
And I think it's important to see the students as representatives of the student council. Mm-hmm. So these may not be items that they're bringing to you to say, please fix, but it's items that they're going to grapple with as a council, with Liz Davis as their advisor, and obviously with Tim Ruggieri as the principal and many other people. So I think it's good that you're aware of the issues that are being addressed within the high school.
Thank you.
Get it.
You're welcome to stay if you'd like, but we understand if you don't.
Feel free to go.
One thing that I did not mention earlier, and I did, I have had a few people ask me if we could be out in time to be home by 9 o'clock. So we will do our best to get everybody home by 9 o'clock. Next item on the agenda is new business. Does anyone on the committee have any items to be considered for the agenda for future meetings? Okay, none. Reports and deliberations. Next, we are going to receive a report on the progress and actions of the Triton CPAC by co-chairs Renee Toth and Melissa Sessions.
Absolutely. Only one chair. Is Missy here? No?
Okay.
So I just actually want to also apologize on behalf of Dave McGee, who is not sitting here. He obviously was intending to be here. But because of an own family emergency, wasn't able to be here tonight. So he certainly sends his apologies. I know you've met with him, and this presentation was done in concert, as we hope everything is done between the CPAC and the district.
So I am Renee Toth. Melissa Sessions was a co-chair with me this past year. She's unable to be here this evening. Just to give you a little background of what the CPAC is, we stand for the Special Education Parent Advisory Council, and we are basically required to exist by law. And if you go through my report that I wrote, our duties include advising the district on matters that pertain to the education and safety of students with disabilities. We are to meet regularly with school officials, and we're to participate in the planning, development, and evaluation of the school district's special education programs. Our membership is open to anybody, and a small distinction is voting membership is reserved for parents and guardians who are in the district. Most of us have a challenge, you know, with evening meetings and children with special needs. So we do invite families to bring their children with them to any of our meetings and activities, understanding that's a major barrier. Our mission was laid out via our bylaws when we kind of reestablished 3 years ago. It's somewhat repetitive of what our legal mission is, but what we aim to do is advise the school committee on matters that pertain to the education and safety of students. Again, meeting regularly. We're to coordinate the presentation of at least one workshop annually for teaching about what the basic legal rights are of students. And we also try to provide a support network for parents who have children with special needs and try to trade information back and forth. We're doing that. We try to provide communication between CPAC members, our local, state, and national organizations, councils, and groups, and try to just communicate within the district for the understanding, acceptance, and inclusion of students with special needs. And also, one of our missions is to provide education and information through forums and workshops to parents, educators, speakers, and professionals. Just to highlight, last year our board was me and Melissa, Diane Fritzen, and Vicki Miles. This year, so far, I am the chair, and Diane and Vicki are remaining in their positions, but we do have building some appointed positions. Diane Fritzen is going to be a representative for the high school community, Samantha Parker at Newberry Elementary, Mary Sparks at Pine Grove, Diane Carroll at Triton Middle School, and Vicki Miles at Salisbury Elementary. And hallelujah, I found someone to coordinate a mailing list. Diane Carroll will be doing that, which will be instrumental to us getting information out to people. To give you a few highlights of what happened in the last year, we did a membership coffee. We had a great presentation by a neuropsychologist, Angela Curry, called Stressed Out Students, How to Recognize, Manage, and Reduce Anxiety in Children and Teens. We had 63 parents and staff members come to that. We sat on the superintendent's hiring committee. We had another presentation on the 10 traits of effective parents in special education. We teamed up with the ARC of Greater Newburyport in Haverhill to do a workshop on transition planning. And we also submitted questions when Newberry Elementary was hiring a physical education teacher to try to make sure that their expertise included special needs children. And we sat here, gosh, last fall to talk to you guys about our thoughts on the district's coordinated program review. We also reviewed a couple memos, and one of our highlights was establishing a scholarship fund last year to allow students, well, yeah, we were open to students, to allow parents and staff members to attend the conference that is run by the Federation for Children with Special Needs. It's in March, and we were thrilled when 10 parents and 6 staff members took us up on that. It was $95 per person to attend, and we received wonderful feedback from those who were able to attend. And then I was in on a leadership conference with the ARC as well. So fast forward, we just did our planning meeting for the year on Monday, and that was where we had elections again. We also talked Brian's ear off with our opening his open forum. There are many of us parents who are very passionate and see the district's strengths and challenges in probably different ways than some parents. And so we talked a little bit about what we want to do in the coming year. One of our challenges is, frankly, we want to be able to stand up to our legal obligation of being recognized and used by the school committee and the district administration. We really haven't been much, but legally, we're supposed to be. We'd like to have improved communication with the district administration. After meeting with David McGee, he's agreed to meet with me at least every 2 months, and we did talk before our meeting last week. We also hope to further identify areas of strength and weakness in the district from the parents' point of view and share them with the administration and school committee. We want to continue our work to make sure that our district is following legal timelines and proper procedures, since that coordinated program review is only once every 7 years, and that's a long time for a child if their program is not what it should be to wait 7 years for that to be caught. We'd like to be involved in some of these special education budget discussions. You know, just as a school council is aware and discussed what is happening in the building budgets, we feel the CPAC should be getting notified and being asked for input on that during the budget process. And we want to establish more of a presence in the schools, whether it's with family, teachers, or administration. We want to continue to build a culture that is very accepting of all students with or without disabilities. We also have plans to have some great speakers and programs for parents and staff. We have a couple folks who have already started to line up some speakers, and we're looking at having some workshops on anxiety, the legal process, dyslexia, ADHD, and also a forum with all of our state representatives. Somehow, so far, they're all looking like they're going to come on one night. So I encourage you. And that tentative date is January 18th, so that might be one to make sure people come to. We also voted to continue our scholarship program. We want to open it up a little bit, and we will be putting out our criteria. We are going to make available 20 scholarships of $100 each for staff and parents to be able to choose their own educational workshop. That includes members of the school committee. We are aware that the more training everyone can get on special education, the better off our students will be and the more understanding there will be. We also want to expand our reach through our email lists, through a website. We'd like to provide information that goes out with any correspondence from the district to families, like, you know, a little flyer that is included with their IEP, which the district is friendly to. We just need to submit it and design it. And then there's been some of the other surrounding towns have been without a CPAC for several years, and this year they have reemerged and formed, and so we're looking at potentially sharing some of our presentations back and forth and coordinating with them. Another small thing, that's a big thing, is I was recently appointed to serve a 3-year term on the State Special Education Advisory Council, where it's members of all sorts of stakeholder groups in the state, in the private sector, as well as a portion of the membership being parents. So I had my first meeting on that last week. So that is the overall where we are. What we have found is we want to do a lot, but the nature of parents who have children with special needs is they're pretty tired and don't have a whole lot of extra time to give. And so while there's many who want to be involved, it's a small core group who can figure out that balance. But there's a lot of people who cheer us on behind the scenes. We run into the grocery store and we get an earful often about what's working, what's not working. And that's sort of my challenge as CPAC chair, is to recognize when something is one individual's problem versus a trend. So I look forward to working with everyone here in the coming year. This will be my fourth year. I'm not necessarily wanting to run the CPAC forever, but I also don't want to see it dissolve. So, any questions?
Any questions for Renee? Paul?
I just want to say congratulations on your statewide position. I do have one question. When you talk about SPED and being more involved in the budget discussions, is that something that you've learned from another area CPAC unit where they may have had involvement in the budget?
Well, I think that if I look at it like on the top level, we were not notified, for instance, that a special education position was being cut from one of the elementary schools. That's kind of a pretty big thing. That if the numbers worked out that that makes sense, that's one thing. But if not, it would have been very helpful to understand that, in a sense, to rally the troops. and understand what impact that may or may not have. So I'm just going off the model of if a principal sits down with their school council, should the administration be sitting down with their CPAC when it comes to the CPAC budget and let us know what it's looking like? If we're adding a program, we should probably know that, because again, you go back to the CPAC's legal duty is to advise the school committee and the administration. So we can't do that if we don't have all the information.
Any other questions for Renee?
Just a couple questions. One of my questions, I was curious about the, sorry, I forgot what they were termed, the building representatives and kind of what they do and how they function. Since is this new?
Well, yes and no.
Okay.
In theory, we like to have someone available so that if someone is new to the process and they contact me and they say, I'm at Salisbury Elementary, I don't even know how to begin. I don't know personally the people who were involved in that school. And so to give someone the name of someone who kind of knows the players and can advise them of, you know what, start by turning in your letter to this person, or, you know what, yeah, you know, feel confident. It's an evolving role that, while we've tried to have it in the past, they haven't done a whole lot. I would love to make it that the building reps sit in on a school council meeting, or, you know, they're the ones who are letting us know what's going on in the building that may be a trend, but it's going to take time for people to understand that role, and again, the willingness of people to take on that responsibility is sadly limited. But we have some passionate, strong people who really want to help.
One of my other questions is, I'm sure we had a conversation about this, just the information and where information comes from to help educate school committee members. I'm sure that you get a lot that's very specific to special education. I know we get some, it's very general with some special education specific. Is there a way to get some of that information funneled so that we have access to it as well? I mean, I'm just saying, thinking some of it may be more specific than what we need to know, but some of it would be good. And I know personally, I would have loved to make a meeting. I haven't had one yet that I can make. So having that specific time to go is difficult, but if we have something to review on our own time, that makes it a whole lot easier. I think that's just my personal.
Which kind of information are you referring to? Like that there's a conference on autism, or that we're hearing from parents XYZ?
I'm thinking more research that may be going on, maybe a program that has had success elsewhere that isn't here, or, you know, something
yeah,
more along that line.
I'm not very informed on how other school committees get their knowledge mm-hmm. of the special education world. I'd be happy to explore that, because I think it's extremely important, and not only for you, but for the community at large to understand. One thing I would love to do is, we have yet to schedule that legal, the basic rights, which would be fabulous for everybody to attend. And so perhaps we can work together to find a time that maybe it is easier for school committee members to attend. I understand we all only have so much time, but that's a big basic one, so that you understand why certain things have to happen and the mandates that are out there, and that we really don't have a choice in funding certain things, and that also maybe we should fund more than what is the minimum.
And I think my last one is more a comment than a question, and maybe this is a Jim Montanari question. Sorry, Jim, to put you on the spot. But I think I saw on Facebook a couple of events that the Salisbury Elementary PTA is hosting in the spring that might be some crossover with what the CPAC is doing. Am I remembering correctly? Yeah. Excellent. Thank you, Jim.
Which is where it will be fabulous when we reestablish the it used to be the District Coordinating Council, where the heads of all the groups meet. Also, in the past, the CPAC a couple years ago was invited to go meet with the leadership team. We were invited to go to some of the school councils. And frankly, I'm a volunteer. I'm not able to just keep extending myself over and over saying, I want to be there, I want to be there. I would welcome us being invited once in a while. That traditionally last year was a very separate, the CPAC was not involved the way we really should have been. And so I'm hoping that this year that will be different.
Anyone else? Thank you, Renee.
You're welcome.
Next on the agenda is the Salisbury Elementary School Principal Jim Montanari on his PBIS program and the focus of social and emotional learning.
Yes, the color is only on the cover.
Thank you. Say that again into the microphone. Yes. Only color on the cover.
I love it.
Thank you.
Black and white, I hope.
Thank you. Left-handed with the attorney. That's yours. This one. Yours is all color. All right. Well, good evening. Thank you for this opportunity to speak about Triton's PBIS initiative and how SES is implementing the school-wide positive behavior support. First, I'd like to thank my PBIS teacher leaders, Darlene White, Ellen Lincoln, Maureen Wynn, Jane Keeler, Anne O'Brien, and Terry Gilbert. PBIS, positive behavior support, is a process for teaching children appropriate behavior and providing the supports necessary to sustain that behavior. PBIS is not a curriculum, it's a framework for systems to identify needs, develop strategies, and evaluate practice towards success. What is school-wide positive behavior support? It's the application of evidence-based strategies and systems assist schools to increase academic performance, increase safety, decrease problem behaviors, and establish a positive school climate or culture. School-wide approach with other initiatives have been very successful with Foundations, Wilson, Math and Focus, Keys to Literacy, WIN intervention. We want to make sure that anything we implement, it helps teachers work smarter, not harder. As you can see on page 2, there is a system of designing school-wide system for student success. Using this diagram frame teachers' thinking as how we are going to approach PBIS. This first school-based PD in August was an opportunity to roll out PBIS specifics at SES, and this was teacher-led. Over the summer, I attended Wilson Leadership Conference and met Pete Hall, who suggested schools reference, and I should say, Pete Hall suggested that schools should reference mission statement constantly. Basically stating why you do what you do. The SES mission statement is as follows. The mission of SES is to provide our community of learners a system of consistent behavioral expectations to support academic growth. My PBIS leaders collected data from the staff asking what areas and concerns they had regarding behavioral issues and approach to such issues. The common SES concerns were transitions in hallways, recess and lunch behavior, supervision in all areas of SES, common understanding of the rules, consistent reinforcement, and common language and procedures. It was clear whatever we did, consistency matters. We have to have a common vision, a common practice, and a common language. If we have those three areas covered, we will be successful. The PBIS leaders developed this chart, which is on page 4, or this matrix, to help teachers and students to understand expectations. We just cannot tell students to behave. We have to talk to them. We have to explain. We have to demonstrate. We have to remind. We have to practice, and we have to model. In other words, we have to teach these skills. So where to begin? We decided to begin with the voice levels. We have 4 voice levels. We have level 3, which you can see on page 5. Level 3 is recess. Level 2 is inside speaking voice. Level 1 is whisper. And level 0 is silence. We also had the voice levels to focus in on the areas of the most non-structured time in the school. Recess, the CAF, hallways, and the bathrooms. We created posters that include the voice level, school rules, and a definition of what being respectful, being safe, and being responsible at recess, the CAF, hallways, and the bathroom. I would also like to thank Jane Keeler's sister, who created the posters, which are color-coded and hung up throughout the school. And you can see through page 5, 6, and 7, you have recess, voice level 3, cafeteria, voice level 2, hallways and stairwells, voice level 1, and bathroom, voice level 1. As a group, we decided not to have voice level 0. The time when we have a voice level 0 is when a line of students are going through the hallway. However, if you have 2 or 3 students walking in the hallway speaking in at a nice voice level 1, that is appropriate. So the next step was the introduction to students. We showed students a funny, quirky little video, PBS Good and Bad Examples, the right way and the wrong way. It was a video of students walking and playing, etc., correctly, with the adult doing it the wrong way. The message to all, we need to meet students where they are, then work from there to start. We needed to make sure students, The message to all, we need to meet students where they are, and then work from there. We had to start where we needed it to make sure students understood that before we start anything with reading and math, we have to make them feel safe, be happy, and show confidence. Then, and only then, will students be able to learn how to read well, use number sense, and demonstrate empathy. This was shared by me to all students, all grade levels, at our community gathering after the video. After our community gathering and during the month of September, Ellen Lincoln and Darlene White taught specific lessons to all the grade levels and classes. This was done during Unified Arts, which is specialist meeting on Fridays, with all staff present for at least one lesson and grade level. On pages 8 through, I believe, 10, there are pictures you will see where students are wearing T-shirts with checks on them. They were the students modeling proper behavior. You also see Ellen Lincoln in one of the pictures with a T-shirt with an X because she is performing the bad behavior. We also had students interacting with cardboard or pieces of paper with X's so they would understand the good and the bad behavior. So we had the voice, We had the modeling of the good and the bad behavior. Then we had the acknowledgement system, which was the next step. This was the toughest part. Handing out super tickets to classes and students for proper behavior. The super tickets are basically tickets you would get going into a movie theater or a fair. These are worth one. These are the golden tickets that myself and Ms. White are able to give to students or classes, really, and they are worth five. The problem here is that there's a mindset on rewarding good behavior that we had to address. We have really two groups, or three groups. One who's in favor, and then the other two groups. You have one group of educators who might feel that students should do the right thing, and it seems like bribery. And then there's another opinion, another group, that everyone should really get a trophy because they're all trying. So we're really talking about a mindset. So I ask my staff to keep an open mind and honestly just try this, or at the very least, trust me when I tell you that this is the right thing to do based on the following data that I have learned. Once appropriate behaviors have been introduced and taught, they need to be recognized on a regular basis. Research indicates that you can improve behavior by 80% by just pointing out what someone is doing correctly. I'd almost want to be able to do anything to improve behavior 80%. Change can happen within a school if we have at least 90% of educators on board, and I'm proud to say that we do have at least that. We developed a very specific acknowledgement system, which was shared with teachers and explained to students, which you can see on page 11. And there were rules put into place for all to follow. Basically, regarding the ticket system, we have students are given a ticket to represent their class, not the student individually. So for example, if I saw Ms. Savy's class walking down the hall, correctly, I would give to the ticket to a student and say, excellent line, and that student gives that ticket to Ms. Savy as a class, as a team, as Ms. Savy's class. They are collected on a weekly basis every Thursday. They are counted, and then there is a class that is recognized at each grade level with the number of tickets. The greatest amount are recognized. That Friday, the teacher in the class with the greatest amount of tickets are able to pick a special event. Some have been, it depends on anywhere from kindergarten to sixth grade, extra recess, extra art, free time writing, extra computer time. This is new. So what we're doing is we've collected ideas through Google Docs to share among educators. At the end of the month, we will count up the tickets, and it will be for each, the greatest for grade level from intermediate and primary. We haven't done this yet, so I will let you know how it works out. On page 11, got off script. On page 11, you have student recognition, and recognition of good decision-making and achievements on the part of students and adults goes far in helping students develop positive self-worth and motivation to achieve. Again, if we're talking about having students feel safe, be happy, and show self-confidence, this plays right into that. So this is the right thing to do, and we're very pleased with how things are going. It is no easy task, and I want a special thanks to Ellen Lincoln, who's really taking the initiative on collecting the tickets and distributing them throughout. Now, what about PBIS in the classroom? We provide a student behavior management flowchart explaining what behavior is classroom managed versus office managed. This is on page 12. Dr. Brooks states that once a teacher sends a student to the office, that teacher loses all power. That student thinks that, or realizes, or questions who really is in charge. And keep in mind that the teacher is the most influential person in that student's life. For that person to lose the power can be devastating. Over the years at SES, we have had hundreds of office referrals in a year. Then the focus changed to the 10% of students causing 80% of the issues. Now we've had less than 6 office referrals in this year since the beginning of this implementation of the PBIS. Full disclosure, this does not include the bus.
Work in progress.
Which is another presentation in itself. If a student has an issue in class, a minor incident form is filled out, as you can see on page 13. If a student collects 3, then the office will be involved. However, by this time, parents have been notified and a problem-solving process has already begun. We've also started passing out positive office referrals. A teacher can send a student to the office for a positive incident. They come, bring the certificate down, they get the picture taken, posted, and then we have the student calling their mother or father to explain that they've received a positive office referral. This is a work in progress, because you're usually when a student says that they're in the principal's office, the reaction to the parents are panic and dismay. So we've had to explain to the parents that this is a good thing to be called down to the principal office. This will take time. At the beginning of the school year, the district has done a great deal of professional development on social and emotional behavior. Overall, the message is we are building a foundation for each student we teach. Our job is to make sure students leave with more bricks in their foundation than they first arrived. And this is done on a daily basis, which brings me to the 5-to-1 ratio, which reminds us all about the impact of positive and negative interactions. If a student receives a 5-to-1 ratio or better of positive interactions, the more bricks they will have in their building their foundation. Basically, it comes out down to this. For every 1 negative interaction, an adult, teacher, staff member, parent has to make that, to negate that negative interaction, they have to equal it with 5 positive. If not, they're always going to be in the red. We have the students on board. We have the teachers on board. Now we have to work with the parents and the community. A parent letter was sent out to all parents stating what PBIS was all about. At academic night, also known as open house, I showed a Dr. Lavoie clip called When the Chips Are Down. It was a dated clip, but the message of self-esteem and building that foundation was the same. He just used poker chips instead of bricks, and he mentioned the 5-to-1 ratio, and he also mentioned Dr. Brooks. And again, in education, I think it's very important to make sure to remind people that this is not new. Everything here, everything that we're doing is connected to what our purpose is regarding reading well, number sense, demonstrate empathy. I reminded the parents on academic night that our main focus is, again, for students to feel safe, be happy, show confidence, and then and only then we can teach students to read well, use number sense, and again, demonstrate empathy. SESPTA is reaching out to all communities, Salisbury, Newberry, and Raleigh, offering a free parent speaker series. We have Dr. Englander, who's going to focus on cyberbullying and social media. We have Dr. Appelstein, focusing on no such thing as a bad kid, who was part of the district's year-long social and emotional focus. Again, everything is connected. Dr. Lyons, anxious kids, anxious parents, interrupting the worry cycle. Huge thanks to the SESPTA and the President, Jen Rocketennis. With any initiative, some things will work well, others not so much. And we've developed an SESPD plan, which is really a working document, providing teachers with what they need to be successful and keeping everything connected and worthwhile. We just finished our first half-day professional development, where we focused on the pbis.world.com. This was a website for teachers to log on and use the PBIS philosophy and intervention and place it in with place for three specific students. We're not going to wait until our next school-based professional development, because I think that's in March or February, but we are going to give teachers 3 weeks to have picked the three students, provide the interventions, and report back, and we're going to do that during collaboration in the first week of November. This is an exciting time because we have. There's a certain feel. There's always been a certain feel in Salisbury Elementary School of, I think, excitement and a certain energy. But there's also now a certain feel of calmness and really a sense of community that's building between. I find that the teachers, the students, and the parents and staff throughout. Again, thanks for the opportunity. I hope I didn't take too much time, and I'd be happy to answer any questions you may have.
Any questions for Mr. Montanari?
Jim, I think this is wonderful that this is school-wide, because a lot of behavior problems develop when one teacher does one thing, they go to another classroom, the expectation's different in the cafeteria. I think this is just terrific, and I want to commend you for it.
Thank you. And I have to, with the teachers, with the office referral and that flow chart, there were some reminders of following the flow chart regarding of what is an office referral and what is not. And there was also a perception of making sure that myself and Ms. White is not implementing it so we have more free time, that we didn't want to deal with it. It was the main fact of the of what Dr. Brooks stated. If the student is or asked to leave and use the office, all power is lost by that teacher. And we don't know when that power is ever going to, if ever, is going to get back. And if the teacher is the most influential person, they can't lose that power. So they need to stay in the classroom. Sometimes we go to them, necessary. However, they're the ones who have the most influence. They're the ones with the power.
Anyone else? Questions?
That's one quick one. This actually occurred to me after Beth Yando's, but it carries over to yours as well. I'm just curious, you have a number of non-readers in your school, and it seems like a lot of this is, at least the reminders, is based on signs. For the younger classes, are they reading the signs as they enter a location to
Color-coded. Color-coded, I believe three is red, yellow, blue. And also the younger age is in kindergarten, the teachers walk down the hall with signs of the number as well as the color.
Okay.
So yes, we took that into consideration.
Any other questions? Thank you very much.
Oh, thank you.
I just would say that one of the important pieces that you heard Jim speak about is the fact that this is the staff. I mean, he mentioned that there were three camps of faculty with it, or faculty and staff, who had differing opinions on this. So it's not a, here's what we're doing, here we go. This is a process of building consensus around a model. And across the district, this has been completely embraced by the teachers who were trained and who are rolling this out. So that's when we know an initiative will be effective. So
very good. Next item on the agenda, the District Communications Committee. You have two sets of notes, one from a meeting on March 23rd, 2016, and the other from the meeting held on October 6th, 2016. These minutes, are just for your information. We do not approve them. If you have any questions about anything, of course, you can bring that forward. The main topic of conversation that night, other than the fact that the stadium was opening, and that was a wonderful thing, was the regional agreement. Just for public's information, for a long time now, the school committee had wanted to look at this regional agreement and see what things might be updated, make more relevant, make more beneficial to both to all parties. And last year, our finance subcommittee took on the responsibility of going over the regional agreement. So at our meeting with the three towns on October 6th, we distributed a copy of the regional agreement with the suggested changes. And we went over them, but we asked that the people from the representatives from the three towns take that back to their three towns and come back with feedback, things that they would agree with, like to change, disagree with, anything on that. And so that was the main part of the meeting.
Anything else that you?
No, I think that was the whole meeting. I think just a note for the towns that there was some confusion about this was necessarily the school committee's idea that we review the regional agreement. This has been an ongoing discussion for at least 5-6 years. So this was an effort from the 2014-15 school year. It was an agreement within the DCC that the committee would start the process rather than bantering around different topics to go through the agreement in its entirety, come to the towns with a proposal of what you as a committee believe would make sense as changes. And so that, as you mentioned, occurred over the course of the year, and then that was presented last week. So just to clarify and make sure that this was not the brainchild of the committee looking to make drastic and sweeping changes to the agreement.
Then this was a starting point for further discussions. We have other meetings already scheduled. Any on the committee want to make any comments about any of that? Okay. To receive an oral report of the success of the Friday, October 14th, 2016 grand opening of the stadium.
So Alex, you will take this in with the superintendent's report because it's actually listed in and meant to take that off as an agenda item.
We'll move along to the monthly report of the superintendent of schools.
Thank you, Deb. I felt like a great announcement. So as many of you were, most of you were there, we certainly appreciate you being in attendance. We do not have an exact tally as of yet. We are actually meeting tomorrow to debrief and go over how things went and look at some details, but we ordered 2,500 tickets. I believe we gave North Reading 200 to sell, and I believe in the vicinity of 50 came back unsold. Do you have an exact number? No. Okay. So, and then there was maybe another 100, 150 or so that were not sold. So our estimates are in the vicinity of 2,200 to 2,300 individuals that came out for that game. Obviously, the outcome of the game was not what we had hoped, but the excitement was high, and that is always a difficult environment to play in as an athlete, especially your first time in front of the home crowd that large. But it was so exciting to see alumni, and whether it be recent graduates or graduates from 20, 30 years ago, town officials, committee members, I mean, folks who have been involved in this process. As I wrote in the report, Dina, of course, the woman of records, went back, and our first meeting was September 1st of 2011. So that was the first meeting after we had decided that this was going to be a stadium project. So a year plus prior, we were looking at an issue with the track and figuring out how to deal with the track, and that was in conjunction with the bank as well. So this has really been a 5-6+ year project. So to be standing out there Friday night for me was certainly, it was an awesome sight to watch everyone enjoying it. Bleachers hold 1,512, and I'm pretty sure you couldn't have packed one more person in there. Certainly the layout is going to be a benefit for any of our groups or any groups that are going to rent it as far as capacity with concessions, because if you tried to buy a hamburger or a slice of pizza, you were waiting for 20, 30 minutes. And from about 6 o'clock, I believe they opened up, and 5 minutes to go in the game at 9:05, and there was still a line. So we are still, so Friday night was an absolute success. I did mention in the report, and I want to mention it publicly, there was an assumption that electricity was all working. And again, we were talking about roofers coming down off of ladders at 4:15 and lights being wired at 5 o'clock. So wire nuts literally being finished off. I mean, you could not have cut it any closer. But there was an American flag, a brand new American flag, and there was the Triton Viking flag hanging into to the right of the scoreboard, and those lights did not work. So there, I certainly, my apologies to anyone who was offended by that. Certainly the moment I turned around in the middle of the field, oh, they're flipping the coin, and saw that, it was a little bit of shock and awe. So so certainly my apologies. There was no intended message there. But as far as the balance of the project, we are into the punch list phase. Some of the building items are bigger than punch list items, but we're working through them. Staining of the floors, baseboard, finishing off of the signage. There'll be a floating T logo on steel rods across the entryway. And then on the field side, there will be, I think they're 44-inch letters. It will say Triton Vikings on that tall wall that's vinyled on the stadium or on the field side. I want to send a thanks to Shahovitz Landscaping and Environmental Landscape, or ELM. Met with the representatives of both of those groups. They do work here, both the fields and snow removal. And they're donating significant labor to deal with some of the landscaping. So there will be a garden out front, that main plot in the middle, where bricks, and I don't have a tally yet, but it's in the vicinity of 200 plus. Engraved bricks that were purchased. That includes the refurbishing of about 24, I think, bricks from the original project that we had those restored. So that is TEF fundraising money. We'll pay for the bricks and all of the product. They will be installing it as a donation. Also some plantings, trees, whether some of the costs will be charged to the stadium project, but all of the labor will be donated. So certainly thank you, huge thank yous to those two companies. And we met today so that will all be in place for the Thanksgiving game. So that those folks who have bought a brick over the last five years, which I was looking at some of those donation checks that were dated 2012. So to those donors who gave long ago and were hopeful and trusted that this would happen, and folks that were still writing checks, I think I saw some people, Patrick, running in first thing Monday morning, still running in with a check. So all of those did make it into the final order. So that will certainly be something exciting for those folks who can finally see those bricks installed on Thanksgiving Day. So, any questions about that? I mean, I think, you want to add anything?
I was personally happy to see no line in the ladies' room.
So,
just saying.
With
just
the full ridiculousness of the state code,
I know.
If there is ever a line, I will be shocked. So, moving on in the report. So, you have in your packet tonight the state accountability reports. Again, under No Child Left Behind, there is an accountability system that has been in place. Under ESSA, the Every Student Succeeds Act, those requirements for accountability have changed. States do have more autonomy. Christine McGrath has been part of a group working at the state level, working through that. There is no official information yet, but there will be. My understanding is that there isn't going to be a wholesale removal of the process, but there will be some tweaks that I believe will make it a more fair and accurate measure. And so you have the reports as they stand this year. This is based on us providing or assessing with the PARC assessment in grades 3 through 8 for mathematics and ELA. We did not use the online version. That version will be PARC is gone. And then in grade 10, it's still the MCAS. As of this coming spring, it will actually be MCAS 2.0 or next generation MCAS, which for all intent and purposes, while the test is not done, it will be likely extremely similar to PARC. So we will not have moved to PARC in vain. I believe that was the right choice to get us into the practice, because of the fact that the next generation MCAS will be very similar to PARC. I'm kind of melding two different sections here together, but we will be taking grades 4 and grade 8 will be taking MCAS 2.0 online in the spring. That is a mandate from the state. We would have to provide documentation to get a waiver if we weren't ready for that. We are going to be ready for that, and our goal this year is to make sure that we work with students in grade 4 through 8 to make sure that they are digital natives, so that when we get to the time of taking the PARC assessment, we're assessing content and standards. We're not assessing a student's ability to use a device. So as far as the data reports, I'm not going to go through them in detail right now. We certainly want to celebrate the fact that Newbury did move to a level one school this year. there is, the rest of the schools remain a level two. As has always been the case, the district is labeled the lowest performing school in the district. So even if we had four level one schools in one level two, we would still be a level two district. So we remain a level two district. We have certainly, principals and we in the central office have looked at the data. I think Kim is doing more looking at data than sleeping. We will be meeting with the principals individually over the coming week, week and a half, and really dissecting this information. There are some strengths or some positives that are in there that we can see and some that are not seen. There are certainly some concerns that have been raised by the data and what we're and where we're performing. And we want to be able to give you an accurate representation both of what that means, be able to tease out what are true needs that we need to improve on, and something that may be something that the data isn't showing accurately, given the fact that tests have been different and the reporting structures have been different, as well as come to you with some answers of how we're going to solve that problem. It's certainly already a topic of discussion that the leadership team has been addressing. Our teaching learning leadership team, as I had shared with you, is working with John Dioria, and we're tackling problems that may not have ever been voiced. I can confidently sit here today and say, I don't believe there are any educators in this district that are operating out of anything other than the best intention of what they believe is right for students. But if we see results that are not showing students making progress, then we have to have the debate about what is the best approach to make sure all students are learning. And that's a good place to be when everyone's invested in making sure students do succeed. So that was the extent of what I intended to share with you tonight. I mean, certainly happy to answer any questions, but on November the 9th, which is actually 3 weeks from tonight, it's a very quick turnaround, on both the November 9th meeting and the December 14th, we're going to come back to you with much more detail and diagnosis of the reports. So,
will they be taking these assessments on Chromebooks?
Yes. In the spring? Yes.
When we looked at the data of the schools that had enough Chromebooks, I didn't see the middle school as having enough Chromebooks for all these students to take their tests.
Well, I don't want to steal any thunder, but Anna Bates has written grants to both, working with Al, and there was a request, full disclosure, Al asked for money. We just didn't give it to him. But Anna Bates worked with Al and actually with Tim Ruggieri, and we're looking for more. We're looking for, I think we're looking for eight through the Institution for Savings. They came back and said that they would match an amount, so that the original grant was 22 was the original ask. They said if you can find 22 to match, they will supply it, but they're not just going to outright match, which is appreciated. The 5 cent savings bank agreed to match 10,000. And so as of today, we had confirmation that the Institution for Savings is going to provide 10. 5 cent savings bank is going to provide 10. So for 20,000, our estimate is that we're going to be able to put three carts onto this campus. There's still a discussion of whether two will live at the middle school and one at the high school, or all three at the middle school, and I can feel the smiles on either sides of me over here. So that's that's still a discussion, but that problem is solved.
Okay. I have two questions. One, were there any surprises in the accountability reporting that you got? Or was this, I'm wondering, maybe that's a Kim question.
Yeah, I would say, I mean, we could get into details, but I don't think anyone was surprised.
Okay. And my other question is, I know we didn't do it at all the schools, and I know they're kind of shifting technology around from school to school, but do you have any concerns? I know you want to make them digital natives in fourth grade. Do you have any concerns about achieving that in time with the level of technology support that's available currently after the cuts that we had last year?
Significant concerns.
Is that
And we will do our best with the people we have in place, but there is no way to sit here, for me to sit here in front of you and say that there is no impact by the fact that we removed three technology specialists last year. There's absolutely an impact.
Is there a possibility of, I don't know, I know there are no additional resources to pull in, but can there be additional practice in the classroom or something just to, even if it's not a level of education, but to give exposure and practice?
Yeah, and I think that's the goal with, we did restore one, so we have one district-wide at the elementary level. And the usage is up. I mean, certainly you can speak to this, but more and more teachers are comfortable using the Chromebooks in their instructional practice. So it's not to say that there's no hope without the technology specialists, but the technology specialists played a key role in what we do at the elementary level. So.
And I was just going to add to that, the State Department has released certain technology components that should be in place and students have had access to and practice with that would help support their taking of the assessment. And remember, it's only fourth and eighth grade. And I can speak to the fact that every walkthrough that I do with the principals and teachers at the elementary level, those kids all have access to Chromebooks and are using them quite frequently within the schools. The middle school, not so much, but because they don't have access to them. So with this grant, hopefully we can get those Chromebooks as soon as possible so they will have that opportunity as well. But Brian is absolutely accurate. I mean, there is definitely an impact. And I know the librarians right now are feeling a major impact of trying to live in both worlds and do the best job that they can. So, yeah.
For children who's like special education children who struggle with taking assessments on computers, how is that going to be handled?
So if there is a child that would do better with a paper pencil, they can use that form as well. Yep, there's options still, either way. Paul?
So Brian, I just have a question on the appointments at the back of your report. It talks about two individuals who are student athlete academic center team leaders. I think there was some discussion about that before, but can you just spell out what they do,
absolutely,
where they are?
I want to make sure I'm looking
on page two, I think.
So we have, it doesn't have the salary. I was just looking to make sure I'm speaking about the right positions. So every day at the end of school, this library turns into the support center. So it was being done through the athletic department. So it was born out of a need for students who might have a practice at 3:30 or 4 o'clock and don't want to go home or don't have a car to go home. They come down here, it's supervised. There are educators working with students. It's not tutoring, but it's there are adults here who are educators who are able to work with students, monitor students if they're self-supportive, but also be here as a resource. So basically then this library is open every day until 3:30. I think 3:30 might be off.
And I don't necessarily, this is just an observation, but at the game the other night, I was fortunate enough to meet and speak with Mike Jones, the CEO from the Institute for Savings. And I want to reiterate how thankful the district should be to him as providing the anchor donation for the track and stadium. And now it seems that they're donating additional stuff for the Chromebooks.
I think it's important to say that the $600,000 that was donated for the Institution for Savings Stadium is the largest single donation, but when you add up the amount that the Institution for Savings has provided to Triton over the years, it's well in excess of $1 million. And if you look at the amount of money they've given to all the area schools, any school where they have a footprint, they are donating, and they're donating significant sums of money. So as they continue, I think Michael told me that they're 17 branches now, I believe. I may be off on that. But as they get footprint larger and larger into the kind of North Shore Cape Ann area, they're making these kinds of donations all over the place. So they're a phenomenal organization that they put their money where their mouth is.
The credit recovery specialist, is that to recover money for sports and?
So for students who may have failed a class and need to gain the credits back. There's a credit recovery program. So we use, say Blackboard, what do we use? Fuel Education, thank you. Fuel Education, it's the same program that we use for a homebound student that may not be able to attend school, where there's different structures where it could be homebound, where there's one of our teachers as the liaison. You can have a fuel education teacher as the virtual liaison. But credit recovery is very specific. If you don't have the credit in this class or have failed it, you can take it, and it's a very explicit. It's not retaking the full course. It's rehitting all the competencies to provide the credits. But it then gives them the credits on their transcript. So continuing on, just a couple more quick items in the report. NEASC update. So just to give you an update, we were due for a mid-cycle in 2015. We didn't hit that mark. As you know, NEASC has gone through significant, we'll call it turmoil. There was considerable pushback on the NEASC process as being overly prescriptive and incredibly redundant, given the federal and state accountability systems that are already in place. Working with a group from the Department of Ed, from MASS, some superintendents, as well as some high school principals, NEASC has revamped their process. George Edwards, who is the director of the Public Schools Commission, I met with him along with Principal Ruggieri and Assistant Principal Daw. I know George was back out today meeting with the high school council, high school council, that Tim set that up. And they are going to be scheduled to be here on December 14th to provide an update. Based on what we heard, it is a much more fluid process. It's a much more efficient process. That's not to say it's not an incredibly taxing process still, but it was helpful to have George sit there as a membership organization and say we were long overdue for these changes. We needed to adapt, recognize if we've gone through a coordinated program review through the Department of Education, that there might be a standard that they don't have to assess on their visits because they can take the same data that was provided to the Department of Ed and marry that and call that standard met. So they've done a lot of work. It's been in conjunction with superintendents and principals, and certainly working with Tim and myself, we feel confident that it's a much improved process. We all agreed with George Edwards that Triton High School would be they call it a 2020 school. So that would be the first year for a designation, for a reaccreditation, that the full process would be revised. So the new standards will have been rolled in, the new process, and the new timelines will have been completely rolled in by that time frame. So this year we'll be planning lots of discussions. The formal process ramping up to the visits would begin in the 17-18 year. I think it was certainly something that I'm supporting. There was a lot of pushback, but I believe that everyone agrees that this makes sense at this point, and it's certainly an accreditation we value. And to confirm that there will be no lapse in accreditation by us moving to a 2020 school, because we were due in 2015. Beyond the schools that said we're kind of taking a step back, NEASC was actually approaching schools and saying, just hold it in abeyance, just stand tight, we're going to figure this out. So there's no detrimental effect. We remain a NEASC accredited high school, and we will. The plan is to be a 2020 school, and you'll hear more detail about that in December. And then the final item is the District Wellness Committee, just to let you know that we are, we'll call it Wellness Committee 2.0, is going to be revamped and reintroduced under Kimberly's guidance. Going to make this a more inclusive group in regards to what we're looking at as far as wellness. The Wellness Committee previously agreed really as a compliance exercise, looking at items like vending machines and school lunches. So there was an identified need for health and wellness curricula. That has not been achieved yet. We know there's a significant price tag to that. But I think we need to add social emotional wellness as not just a topic to be discussed, but as a significant portion of the wellness discussion. So that hopefully by early November, early mid-November, the first meeting would be scheduled. Dina Sullivan had been the school committee rep to that in the past, and my understanding is that she would be interested in continuing in that role. So just to give you that update. So any questions, I'd be more than happy to answer them.
I don't see any.
I won't talk anymore.
You might have to. The next action under action items, vote for stadium bonds to approve the sale of the $3,200,000 general obligation bonds of the district dated October 19th, 2016 to Morgan Stanley & Company, LLC for the purpose of financing the stadium renovation project. Specific required language for motions and votes are included as an annex for signature by the district secretary. So you have Annex 9 in your packet. And we have a special guest reader, don't we?
Do we?
I don't know. Do we?
I don't know. Do we? Morgan Freeman's here, everybody. So Amy Posick, our district treasurer, is here with us tonight. She and Michelle have spent a lot of time poring over these numbers. I don't know if either of you have anything specific you want to share. No? It's that unexciting. So
we got a great rate.
We got a phenomenal rate. So just historically, a bond anticipation note, we banned the project, so we got short-term loans, and then those are due close of business Friday. So we're cutting it close. So literally, Deb in Dina's place and Maureen as the secretary have agreed to stick around for like an hour and a half to sign off on all of these it's like 5 minutes, I promise. So they've been reviewed by the district treasurer, and it's just this series of documents that are issuing the bonds, the permanent 19, the permanent bonds that will pay off the short-term note. So this is being picked up by courier first thing tomorrow morning. We'll have $3.2 million in our account, and then Amy can write the check to pay off the bonds by Friday. So the problem is the motion is not short. I'm happy to read it if someone else wants to read it.
I mean, I
think it needs to be read into the record.
All right. They want both sides, right? Do you have to read all the numbers?
I
Oh, you do? Yeah, no, I meant the columns and stuff. Okay. Yeah. I'll go.
So you can start with you're moving that the Triton Regional School Committee, the second line.
I would like to make a motion that the Triton Regional School District, Massachusetts, certify that at a meeting of the Regional School District School Committee held on October 19th, 2016, of which meeting all members of the committee were duly notified and at which a quorum was present, the following votes were passed as indicated below, all of which appear upon the official record of the committee in my custody. Further voted that the sale of the $3,200,000 general obligation bonds of the district dated October 19, 2016 to Morgan Stanley and Company, LLC at the price of $3,390,515.64 and accrued interest, if any, is hereby approved and confirmed. The bond shall be payable on October 15th of the years and in the principal amounts and bear interest at the respective rates as follows. Further voted that the bonds maturing on October 15th, 2035 shall be subject to mandatory redemption or mature as follows. Further voted that in connection with the marketing and sale of the bonds, the preparation and distribution of a notice of sale and preliminary official statement dated October 15th, 2016 and a final official statement dated October 12th, 2016, each in such form as may be approved by the district treasurer, be and hereby are ratified, confirmed, approved, and adopted. Further voted that the bonds shall be subject to redemption at the option of the district upon such terms and conditions as are set forth in the official statement. Further voted that the district and the chair of the committee be and hereby are authorized to execute and deliver a continuing disclosure undertaking in compliance with SEC Rule 15C2-12 in such form as may be approved by bond counsel to the district, which undertaking shall be incorporated by reference in the bonds for the benefit of the holders of the bonds from time to time. Further voted
that we authorize and direct the district treasurer to establish post-issuance federal tax compliance procedures in such form as the district treasurer and bond council deem sufficient, or if such procedures are currently in place, to review and update said procedures in order to monitor and maintain the tax-exempt status of the bonds. Further voted that each member of the committee, the district secretary, and the district treasurer be and hereby are authorized to take any and all such actions and execute and deliver such certificates, receipts, or other documents as may be determined by them or any of them to be necessary or convenient to carry into effect the provisions of the foregoing votes.
You can stop there.
Oh, okay.
So that the rest is what Maureen will sign to attest that that's just happened in a public meeting.
Could we have a second on that motion?
Second.
Any discussion?
I do just have a question. On the top of page two at the top where it starts, further voted that the district treasurer and the chair, should that be vice chair?
No, because it has to be the chair. Deb, in Dina's absence, is acting as the chair and will sign as the chair. She is effectively the chair for this purpose this evening. And can I just further clarify, or further vote, that it says $3.2 million bonds, and then it says $3,390,000 and change. So that's premium that is generated to pay off the issuance costs. So that's standard procedure. And actually, the way this was bid, we're actually going to be writing each town a check along with their first payment that's due, because more premium was generated than needed to pay the cost of the bonds. So if you want a lesson in that, you're not going to talk to me. You're going to talk to Amy or Michelle.
I think you told us that initially that would happen.
It was higher than we anticipated, so they're going to get more. But just so that you understand, there's a difference between the $3.2 million borrow that turned into $3.39. We're not stacking $190,000 anywhere.
Any questions? All those in favor? Opposed? It's unanimous. Thank you very much.
It's touch and go there for a while.
Now we have to receive a presentation from the middle school principal and assistant principal proposing the creating of an eighth grade class trip to Quebec in May 2017. Give planning approval to proceed with organizing and fundraising. Final approval will be required upon final details of the trip being confirmed.
Hi. We've distributed some narrative on this trip. We're here to basically answer questions. I'll give you a little rundown of the genesis of this, I guess. I think I was actually on, as a teacher, the last trip that the eighth grade did from Triton Middle School. We went to New York City, and that was about eight, nine years ago. I believe it was stopped basically because it became kind of the have-nots watching the haves go. And it wasn't a very inclusive trip, and it was decided it wasn't really fair. I want to say right off the top that it's non-negotiable for me. Any eighth grader that wants to go on this trip will be on this trip if I have to pay for it myself. We're going to be doing this. We would like to do this in May. It's the week of Memorial Day. It's a three-day trip, two overnights. It's a bus to Quebec City. It's, we feel, a good way to get kids to a kind of European feeling city without having to get on planes and trains and all that kind of stuff. And it's close enough that it's not a killer trip for a lot of eighth graders, and we can get there and back in a reasonable amount of time. This is Rob Aslan. He's our new assistant principal. This trip kind of came together as a perfect storm because I had some comments from parents over the years. I brought this up to teachers over the years. These kind of things are non-starters unless you get commitments from teachers to be able to go as chaperones. So I get some talk about it, and I could never get enough people really on board. So then it would kind of go away for a while. It came up again the last year or so, some inquiries from seventh grade parents about how come we don't do eighth grade trips, some eighth grade parents. Why didn't we do an eighth grade trip? In talking about it one day, Rob happened to be in my office, and he said, you know, I've done a trip to Quebec before quite a few times. So that was kind of, I think, the missing piece, because we had someone that has done this before, has known how to do the planning. I don't believe there's anybody left on our staff that was involved in the last trips. I went, but I didn't do anything of the planning. So it kind of all came together pretty quickly like that. He got right on the his computer and contacted people that he knew. And so we were able to put together what we sketched out for you here. Obviously, there's a lot of unknowns. We don't know the number of kids yet or anything like that. But these people, it's they visit Canada. They do this for a living. They know what they're doing. So that's basically it in a nutshell. Like I said, I want every eighth grader that wants to go on this trip to be able to go on this trip. I assume there's going to be students that just aren't going to want to go, and that's fine. We will have activities for those kids who are not going. So we have a lot of planning to do, a lot of fundraising to do, so we wanted to get here as early as we could and have this discussion and see if we can get going with some traction. So here we are. So I don't want to...
Questions? Yeah. I was just wondering if you guys had any discussion about passports and how that would work, because, I mean, if you want to, everybody... don't think a lot of eighth graders probably have their passports, and I know it's expensive to get one and takes, I think, about 6 weeks.
Because it's a school trip, they only need birth certificates. So the adults would need passports, students only need a birth certificate. Oh. So they'd have to take their original birth certificate and two copies.
Yep. Thank you.
We verify that.
Okay.
Twice.
The company that the high school has traveled to Quebec City with.
I was wondering about the birth certificates. Are you going to be taking collections of who's going to make sure that you have them so that one child forgets theirs at home and has to get off the bus?
Well, let me tell you, that's the most stressful part of the trip is the birth certificates. The chaperone on the bus will go through that list of birth certificates at least 50 times as they drive up to the Canadian border. And it's always easier going into Canada than it is coming back. But yeah, what will happen is the teacher that's in charge of that bus will collect all the original birth certificates and maintain those for that trip.
I was just wondering, so the students that are, obviously it looks like there's a lot of teachers going, the students that are left behind or they choose not to go, are they going to be getting an educational experience during that time? Is there going to be something to try to make it equivalent to the experience that the kids that are going are getting? I'm just wondering, you know.
Well, the trip itself is more or less a celebration of the end of middle school. There is certainly academic things to Quebec City. There's a lot of history there and things like that. But it's mostly for a fun trip. So we would like to provide something fun for the kids that are staying back. We haven't got to that point yet. We have to do numbers and figure out all that kind of logistics on that. But we will, you know, put something forward for those students as well.
My other question was, I assume there's going to be a fairly significant cost associated with this. What are you looking at as a fundraising percentage goal? Do you have any idea?
Institution for Savings have any money left? That's a good question. I mean, the more kids that go, obviously the number changes. Although the more kids go, then we have to add buses, which kind of, you know... I don't know. I don't know the answer to that. Without having done fundraising for something like this for a long period of time, I don't know what to expect. There's obviously a lot of people around fundraising for a lot of different things, so there's a lot of competition. I just think we're going to try to make it as easy for people to, number one, pay for it. There's an electronic online payment thing that they can do. We're going to try to do it a lot of payments so people can have all year to kind of budget it out, if you will. And, you know, I'm hoping we can create scholarship-type things for the kids who just can't afford it, period. That's what I envision. So we have some ideas for fundraisers. We have some dances and things like that we're going to kind of take over and do as fundraisers for this trip. So that's...
Just to clarify, so that the approval they're looking for tonight is planning permission.
Right.
So they would come back when the trip takes shape and say, here's the cost, here's the price, and then you give the final approval for the trip to happen. I mean, you could hold interest meetings with parents, and there could be five students, and it's a non-starter, but I think the interest is probably greater than that. But just to confirm, you're giving them planning approval this evening, or that you're asking for your planning approval.
Paul?
No, and I just have an observation. For the sake of your checking account, are you going to have a cutoff date for when these kids have to sign up? I recognize the have theirs versus the have-nots. That's great. But, I mean, can I have a fairly early time frame so that you have an idea
I believe it's got to be.
It's pretty quick. We're right in the time frame that deposits have to come down. It's usually a $200 deposit. So it's within the next 6 to 8 weeks. We gotta kind of have that number.
Any other questions? So could we have a motion to approve the potential trip to Quebec on May 31st, the planning of the trip?
So moved.
Any further discussion? All those in favor? Thank you.
Thank you.
We'll be seeing you soon.
Ready.
Thanks for waiting around.
Next on our agenda is we have three policies to approve as second readings. Could we have a motion to approve as a second reading the policy on drug-free workplace?
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor? The next one, could we have a motion to approve as a second reading the policy on the prohibition of alcohol, tobacco, and drug use by students?
Second.
Any further discussion? All those in favor? Could we have a motion to approve the policy as a second reading about the teaching of alcohol, tobacco, and drugs?
Second.
Any further discussion? All those in favor?
All right.
And just to confirm for you, the JICH and IHAMB, the teaching about alcohol, drugs, and tobacco, and prohibition for students, those are due to the Department of Education, revised and or added by the end of this month. So we will submit those tomorrow. Patty already has them ready to go. Thank you.
Next item on the agenda is regarding the MASC conference, which is 2 weeks from today, I believe. And every year we have to appoint a delegate to go and vote for us and an alternate delegate for the at the business meeting, which I believe will be Wednesday afternoon. So who is attending?
I'll be attending the whole conference.
You'll be attending the whole conference?
I'm attending, but I won't be there Wednesday.
Okay. Who'll be there Wednesday? All right. So we need a delegate and an alternate delegate. You know me, Dan?
I second the nomination.
Dan, do you accept the nomination?
I think the
proper... It's called hazing.
My condolences, right? Yes, I do.
Okay. Could we have a motion to nominate Dan Valenti as our... voting delegate at the MASC conference?
I will. Yes.
You'll nominate and Paul will second? Okay. Any discussion? All those in favor? We also technically need to vote an alternate delegate.
I'll be the alternate.
Okay. Could we have a motion to nominate Linda as the alternate voting delegate for the business meeting?
I'll make a motion to nominate Linda.
Second that motion.
Any further discussion? All those in favor of Linda as the alternate voting delegate? Thank you very much. The other issue is the resolutions that you all received, I hope, the booklet on the conference. And I don't know if you've had a chance to look over the resolutions. There are four of them. And I went on the website, the MASC website, and you may or may not have noticed, it says, on the advice of counsel, the text of resolutions 2 and 3 are not printed in the MASC delegate manual. So they are on the website, if you want to take a look at them there. And what we have always done in the past is to ask you to please forward your opinions on those resolutions to Dan, in this case. If you have any opinions on how you think he should vote or how the school district should vote, would you please let him know before 2 weeks from today? Any questions on that conference or anything else? I know, Martin.
She was pointing to me, lest I start.
He was pointing to her watch.
He was looking at me. She was afraid I'm going to start talking again.
The other issue, the last issue, is the school committee goals. You all have a draft of the goals. Hopefully you had a chance to look at these. These were the goals that were put together by Brian and Dina after our workshop. we need to approve these goals. Everybody had a chance to look these over? Okay. Could we have a motion to approve the three goals for 2016-2017, one on student achievement, inclusive practice, and advocacy communications?
So moved.
Could we have a second?
Second.
Open
to discussion?
Any discussion?
I just wanted to say, I know we talked about all this at the meeting. I didn't expect to see it all put under three. I feel like it's a lot for the school committee to take on in 1 year. I'm going to trust in the fact that Dina has a plan for this on how to get it all done. But I just wanted to voice that I feel like it's a lot. I'm not sure how we're going to tackle it in a way that we can be effective on all the points that were brought up. And maybe you have insight on this.
I would just say, I mean, they're written in a way that you can make progress. I think that to go from a committee who hasn't taken these actions to taking a step towards these actions is positive across the board. So, I mean, as far as the inclusive practice, if you schedule two or three events over the course of the year, and again, district-wide, but you know, promoted by the school committee, so that you learn more about inclusive practice, that's a huge plus. Are you going to get through the entire, I think it said, and then begin a review? So that could be at your June meeting where you start digging into that. You're not going to get a chance to review all of the policies, all of the handbooks. That's just not going to happen this year. So we tried to write them in a way that you can make some progress towards, you know, unlike a true SMART goal where you say by June 30th, 80% of, la, 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 la. So I agree, it's a lot. But I think the spirit was to find someone who'd be willing to take that on as a leader, rather than assigning to the individual subcommittees. But if there is someone who would want to kind of be the, I wanna take that as my, put on that yoke for the year and run with it. Obviously, it has to involve the full committee. But so
we had a brief talk about this, and what I would suggest for the immediate right now is if you have any specific interest in any one of these areas, if you could this week email me. At this point, Dina does not have a return date. So if you could email me and tell me which of these things you might be interested in. And and Brian and I had a brief conversation about this on Monday, that this, once we get, know who's going to work on what, and start to move forward with them, that we would have updates, regular updates at our meetings on where we are on these goals throughout the year. Dan?
Just that one of them in particular does relate to the work of the policy subcommittee.
That's true. That's true.
Yeah. So there will be some that will.
Yes. Again, this is just, I just want you to send me the information for now. Is that Dina bought a one-way ticket. I don't know when she's coming back. So for now, just send me what your interest might be, even if it's in order 1, 2, or 3. And then hopefully she'll be back soon. But for now. Any other questions? Oh, yes. Didn't we say I said that? Yes. Okay. We have a motion. Any further discussion? All those in favor of the goals? Opposed? Oh, unanimous. Thank you very much. I don't know, it's going to be close, Monique. It'll drive fast. Could we have a motion to adjourn?
Motion to adjourn.
Second? Second. Discussion? All those in favor? Thank you very much.
Okay. Can I just put my preferences on a piece?